My name is Björk, and your television is just about to explode! This is all over because I don't expect this to last at all. It's just a little accident, happy accident. When I move back to Iceland after all this, I want to be able to sit proud in my rocking chair with my grandchildren, with the albums I did way back when I was young and mad, and say, this was done the way I'm proud of this and I don't regret anything. Friend of mine, actually, Graham Massey, he used to send me tapes in the post. Just all the songs, his favorite songs, put on one tape. And I think it's one of the most brilliant, precious presents you can get from a friend. Maybe having a bad day, you keep it in your pocket for the whole day, and then in the evening before you go to bed you take your Walkman and you go to bed after having a bath and you lie there with the Walkman and you listen to the tape and you fall asleep with the tape with the headphones on. So it's like almost like an anthem, like a sort of worship anthem to headphones. And the chorus goes, my headphones saved my life, your tape lulled me to sleep. And it's very much about that. And I decided to use all those things, put a lot of vocals on it, and really try to sort of use the headphone, you know, trick, like sort of da 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 da, all those tricks, and and really sort of glorify headphones.
I'm fast asleep now.
the biggest difference between debut and post is that debut was all songs I wrote over a 10-year period, all in my house in Iceland after my son had gone to bed. So they were quite private and intimate, like little experiments, and more like a diary thing, you know, something in order to keep you sane, rather than you want to tell the whole world about it. This album is on the contrary. I moved to England 2 years ago, and all the songs on this album are written since then. So they're all written with in mind that other people will hear them. They are more, not as shy and introvert. They're probably more sort of conscious and more confident. In a way, Post is quite brave, because it's the girl who left home and is trying out all these brand new things she's never tried before, and tasting all those cities and meeting all these lunatics, and best of all, meeting all the lunatics like herself, you know, because there aren't that many back in Iceland. And communicating with all them and figuring out there are more people out there who feel like her. And it's just, it's definitely like a brave album, but at the same time, kind of scary. Now I can make very angry songs, I can make very happy songs, very sad songs, delicate songs, very vulnerable songs, very strong, aggressive songs. In that sense, Post is a lot better than debut. Technology is about programming, being lazy, and programming like next week or the next concert, and then just sitting and having nothing to do. And that is rubbish as well, because we didn't make technology to be lazy. We sometimes did it to take away boring work for us, but we only did it so we could get more busy on the more freedom things, the things that are more important, and be more creative. That's why technology was made. Most of the rubbish I've ever heard in my life is when people say, there is no soul in techno music. There is no soul in techno music because nobody put it there. You can't blame computers of not having soul in techno music. You blame the people who made the music. You can use all the technology in the world and make the most emotional, soulful, human things. But it's up to you. The humans have to do this.
Be the next pop diva.
I don't know. I just have a mission. I have to do what I have to do, you know? And I have not compromised myself.
When I was a kid, I used to walk a lot outside between my grandma's house, my father's house, my mother's house, my school, my music school. And because Iceland, most of it, it's kind of like nobody lives there. It means that when I walked, I could sing and sing and sing, and nobody could hear me. And that's how I learned to sing, and that's what I did for, I don't know, 10 years or 15 years or whatever of my life. And that was like my little treasure, my little secret. And then when I met an engineer much later, first of all, they tried to ask me to be in one place while I sing, which is absolutely ridiculous to me. It took them ages to teach me that one, and I sort of managed to learn. But then I would sing very quiet and whisper and be all delicate, and the next second I would scream, and everything would explode, and they would have to repair everything, and I would sit there kind of all embarrassed. And so...
But what about coming right up to the present now? I mean, with the current album, with Post. I mean, Army of Me, the single, let's just say the first single. With the movie, Tank Girl, did you have a look at what, the rushes of Tank Girl were at first and decided, yeah, this is exactly what I want?
Well, I liked the comics, and people that did the comics, they asked me to act in the film. But since I'm not an actress, I said no. And then they asked me to put a song in the film. And because I like them, I put that song that I had already made and gave it to them. But I asked them to see the film, and they wouldn't let me see it for some stupid reason. And then they gave me, they sent me the trailer, which is, doesn't really show you the ingredients of films. It just shows you the surface of it. And I thought the surface was kind of all right. And since they wouldn't let me see the picture, I flipped the coin and then ended up giving them the song. And I think all the different type of music are just as important. And they are now, in 1995, this is the same thing. You got the sort of stupid music, because it's very important. You must never stop being stupid. It's one of the most important human qualities to remain stupid. And also the sort of intellectual music, and also instinctive music, and also happy music, and all the different type of music with all the different type of instrument, because you can play music on almost anything, you know? But now I'm doing my second album, and I think the reason why people liked my last album was because I wasn't trying to please anyone. And the thing is, if you don't try to please anyone, there's like a very funny rule. I have learned a lesson that if you don't please anyone, you have a slight chance of pleasing everyone. But if you try to please just one person, or even 10 people, if you try to please them, you won't please anyone. It sounds a bit stupid, but it's actually the truth.
Welcome for Björk. Hello. Oh, Björk. Very good. Have a seat. Excellent. That's right. Yeah. What is a sort of traditional food to eat in Iceland?
Well, it's fish. And then it's we've gotten into them pizzas and things.
Oh, and pizzas, right.
Yeah.
Frozen, naturally.
And are Icelandic people like you? Are they very non-conformist, very unusual, very original?
I don't know. I think of myself as very Icelandic. But when I grew up, all the people there thought I was very strange, called me Chinese, that I must be foreign. And then when I go over to Europe, they say, oh, she's very strange, she must be Icelandic. So I don't know anymore.
Well, you have got this image, haven't you, of being eccentric, of being, as I said earlier, very singular. I mean, I don't think we've got the clip to show, but I mean, Spitting Image did, which is a great, great sort of tribute to you, really. Spitting Image did a puppet of you, and on the Steve Wright Radio 1 show in the afternoon, they used to have a sketch involving you, and where they basically portrayed you as Diana was portrayed, as a kind of basket case, you know? What is it? Why do you think people think you're a bit nutty?
I don't know. I think it's their problem, really. I remember when I was five, and I made a conscious decision. There's two ways of doing things. Mm-hmm. Either the way everybody expects you to be and do it like you're supposed to be, do it and do it like morally correct, or
your
way. The way you can have a fun and a laugh. And I decided to stay on that side of the canyon, and I've never regretted it, you know. And if people on the other side of the canyon who are sort of trying to be sort of middle of the road, very small town mentality, normal, whatever, if they find me awkward from that side of the canyon, well, that's their problem, really.
Now I'm having the time of my life, you see.
Well, basically, I think all people are very different inside, and they've got all these different sides to them, like a silly side, a clever side, a sad side, a painful side, a happy side. And musical styles shouldn't be taken too literally. They're just like something to make these moments, the emotions, bigger. You know, and that's how I look at it. So I've always been very determined that my albums have got all the emotional scale on them, and whatever it takes to make them.
About falling in love. Is there any love in Bjork's life at the moment?
Oh, tons.
Do you have a boyfriend?
It's a secret. I'm not going to tell you that
anymore. Why not?
It's none of your business. You're being nosy.
jam. Starts another big riot. You blow a fuse, sing boom. Damn, the cops lose, sing boom. So what's the use? Wow, bam, I'm falling in love. Sky can't sing, the devil cuts loose. You blow, 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 blow a fuse. Ah, when you fall in
love. Oh, what's her name? Betty
Hutton. Betty Hutton.
Betty Hutton.
Yeah.
Now, did you hear that song go, and did you see the video in your head, or did you take someone who you know makes nice pictures and say, can you help me with this video?
Well, I'm a big fan of Spike Jonze, who did the video, and since, like, 3 years ago, I was waiting for a little project that we could do together.
Mm-hmm.
But very important is to present a person with the right project,
yeah.
You know, so you're unfair. It's like, you know, you don't want people to ask me to say, you know, row a boat or something. You know,
right.
If they want someone singing, they ask me sort of thing.
Right.
So when I have really energetic, happy song, which Spike Jonze is definitely, I asked him.
How did you choose this cover? Where does it come from?
When my band was touring around USA for the first record, we found this tape in a truck stop.
Yeah.
Where they sell the petrol.
Yeah.
Which was called Divas.
Hello.
With all these American divas singing songs. And this song became like the anthem of the tour. We'd always put it on before we go on stage to get excited.
Now, so that's obviously good fun, but that's a slightly unusual track for you.
Well, my two albums I've put now out on my own, debut and post.
Yeah.
And that's kind of why I call them debut and post, which is like before and after.
Right.
Are very much about sort of the collection of what I've done the last 20 years.
Yes.
Because I really love to try everything once before I die.
Yes.
And I'm obsessed with all those things. And
now, people that you say you've been here for 20 years, people might be quite surprised to think, well, how can she be doing this for 20 years? Because you, if I may say so, you look like a sort of 15-year-old. I don't know, you're older than 15, at least definitely 16, I'm going to say. So the...
Yes, female, George, yeah!
Cliche. Of course I could think about 9,000 people, but I would like to thank Derek Burkitt, who stood by my side for 12 years. I'm honored.
Best female international artist. Please.
I was the first child of a mother and a father who had been in love since they were 14 years old. And I was born when my mother was 19, my father 20. And they were very conservative but happy sort of people. And then when my mother had been a housewife for 1 year with me, she freaked out and became a wild hippie and a feminist. And she separated with my father, and my father remained very conservative and married a nurse, but very hardworking, honest, very energetic man, and very full of power and joy for life. And my mother being completely just wanting to be as strong and painting all the walls with butterflies. And I live in a house with a lot of people who have long hair and listen to Jimi Hendrix. So I go between the two families and I learn, okay, maybe freedom isn't having a long hair, and maybe discipline isn't suit, and not take anything for granted. And then I went to music school when I was 5 for 10 years, and they play me classical music all the time. My mother always played me hippie music. It's like guitar solos 24 hours in my house, like on 10. And my my grandparents and my real father, they listened to a lot of jazz and Simon and Garfunkel and all this more sort of conservative music. And I enjoy all of them. I love all of them. And I like immediately to show the three different worlds, not to take granted for they have. So I go with the Jimi Hendrix record to my grandparent and show them that maybe his solos were not far from jazz. And it's very nice. And then I take the jazz record to my music school and show them, or maybe, you know, Miles Davis was related to Stravinsky. Maybe it's not a big difference between the two. And then I take classical music back to my parents. And I like very much to be the outside there and show, you know, the, like, ta-da! Life is not that simple. There's more to it than you think, sort of thing.
I consider myself very lucky. I had a very, very happy childhood. And to be brought up by a hippie mother, I thought was very special. I think the media, because they find me quite peculiar for some reason, they tend to sort of try to find, but why? Did it all go horribly wrong? And then think, oh, it's because her mom was a hippie, and she didn't bring her off, and she suffered when she was a kid. That's not at all the case. I had a gorgeous mother. But the best thing about my mother, she let me do what I wanted. She trusted me that I knew what was for my best, you see. But of course, like every kids do, when you get older, you want to become the opposite of your parents. Yeah. Thank God, because otherwise there'd be no development in the universe, you know? You've got to go further than your parents.
And also, you said before that your favorite subject at school was mathematics. Would you bring a mathematical mind or a bent to the way you make your songs, record your songs, or write your songs?
Music and mathematics are the same thing, you see. And it's a known phenomenon that children who are good, are talented musically, they're very good in mathematics. They may be crap in everything else, and vice versa. It is because of the structure. Half of music, people think music is this gorgeous, completely abstract thing, which is true, but the thing which is gorgeous about music, it's got these complete contrast opposites. Half of it is complete mathematics, the structure of like rhythm is completely, it's just mathematics, like 1, 2, 3, 4, or 7. Then you repeat that 11 times, and you have a build-up, and then you crash, and then it's the outro, and all the structure. It's just a very, very cold, clever landscape you're creating, you know, even you're aware of it or not. The other half of it is completely abstract emotion, which is so gorgeous. So you've got the opposites in the same thing.
I mean, the thing about it is that you're known for so many different things, but one of them being innovative videos. I mean, videos that are different than anybody else's. Is this important to you, or do you find this is just something I have to do that has nothing to do with the music, but it's part of the business?
Well, basically, I come from a bit of a punk background where I think all you have to do is kind of like scream a song in the microphone and then go home and sulk. And then slowly, surely, I've sort of found out that maybe that's not the way to do it. And maybe this is a pathetic, boring explanation, but since I am a woman and a mother of a child, it began especially with debut, I felt that my songs were like my children. And with children, you can't just give birth to them and then say, see you later, you know? You have to make sure, you don't own them or anything, but you have to make sure that they get the best education possible, the best health care, that they are introduced to human nature and learned how to deal with it so people don't treat you badly, and all those things. And then maybe when the kid is 15 or 20 or something, it has to manage on its own, you know? With my music, I tend to try to protect it as much as I can, all the way till it's in a record shop. So it will get the album sleeve that it deserves, it will get the video it deserves, it will get the photographs it deserves. And the photographs are not of me. They are of the person who made that music. And the videos are not about me, they're about the music. So I focus everything on this music that has been created. And that's why I follow up so closely on everything that is done with my music, very, very firmly. And it's not because I'm a control freak and I want to control the universe, because that's probably the thing I'm least interested in, but because I'm very protective towards my music, that's why. First I was going to do this album like on my own, like produce it on my own, and I thought it was a correct way to do it. Then I started getting a bit scared and kind of a bit scaring old big too much for me. So I asked Nelly Hooper, who produced my debut album, to produce this album for me. He refused. He said it was ridiculous that I could do it on my own and I should do it on my own. And then in the end, I contacted him again and said it was too soon for me to do it on my own. And he agreed to be my safety net. When we went to Bahamas to record the album, he had a surprise for me. He prepared and he said, picked up me up in a car one morning, took me to this cave, big cave, which was there, and kind of gave me like a microphone and headphones with a very, very long lead. And I told me to go into the cave and there was absolutely no light in there. And I climbed into it. And then the song came in the headphones and all the music. And I sang the song, like the lyric. And while I crawl into the unknown, cover me. I'm going home to a mystery, cover me. And like if something went wrong, I was supposed to pull the lead and they would come and get me. And they were outside like in the night with headphones and little mixing desk listening to it. And then I heard all these beautiful noises. And then I was actually standing on the top of a little cliff with sort of like a canyon in front of me, like 4 meters down, just on the edge with the microphone. And I realized all the little noises were actually bats, hundreds of bats, kind of like zhoom, zhoom, going past me. So they made all these beautiful little like little noses, and they are on the record.
Going to prove the impossible real.